After exploring the Istrian Peninsula, we took a bus south along the Dalmatian coast about 380 kilometers to the city of Split. The second largest in Croatia, with a population of 200,000, Split is in the lower center of the country. Originally founded as a small Greek colony around the 2nd century BCE, the significant history of the city began when the Roman Emperor Diocletian, a native of the area, built his extravagant retirement villa at the turn of the 4th century CE near to the Dalmatian provincial capital of Salona, modern-day Solon. In the 7th century, long after the fall of the Western Roman Empire, Slavs and Avar horse nomads sacked Salona. Refugees from the city fled to take shelter inside the abandoned imperial palace and the nearby islands. Over the years, the spacious rooms and corridors of the original palace were gradually filled in to house the increasing population, creating the current narrow streets and alleys. In the later Middle Ages, the city outgrew and gradually expanded well beyond the walls. Today, it is a sprawling, modern port city with a thriving, ancient, but still living heart. Our sobe was a 10-minute walk from the nearest gate to Diocletian's palace, in a wonderful neighborhood that has a nearby bakery, cafes, and a couple grocery stores. The neighborhood seems to be a balanced blend of sobe homestays and local residents. It definitely has its own character. The narrow maze of streets makes it easy to get lost, with unreliable GPS and many dead ends. They also make for some of the most challenging and precise parking that we've ever seen. Narrow streets require creative parking and other solutions, and the miniature, by US standards, split garbage trucks are a great example. One of the notably wide streets in Split is Marmontova Ulica, Marmol Street. Napoleon's Marshal Marmol not only conquered the Dalmatian region in the early 19th century, but also urbanized the cities. The street that bears his name is now a beautiful pedestrian promenade with posh shopping and restaurants. There are also street vendor stalls, so not all the shopping is high-end. Just off of Marmol, toward the palace, the Split Fish Market was one of our first stops in the city. With a kitchen in our apartment, cooking fresh seafood was top of our to-do list. On the other side of the palace lies Pazar, the outdoor farmers market. Between the two markets, we got a delicious and affordable start to our first few days' meals. More details will be in our separate food blog. We were able to fill out our shopping list from the many regular markets and supermarkets in the area. We were even able to find a very small Asian grocery, but it's the only one we've seen so far in Croatia. Sometimes, however, despite the available variety, you just can't find what you're looking for. Like most places we've seen in Croatia, public drinking fountains meant we never ran out of water on the hot summer days. Ancient Split is very much a living city, not just a tourist attraction. Diocletian's Palace, the ancient and tourist heart of Split, is a remarkable place to visit. The heart of the palace itself is the peristyle, where the emperor would publicly address his subjects. Today, it is overlooked by the Venetian Age bell tower of the St. Dominus Cathedral. At night, the peristyle is lit, making it seem even more amazing. Peristyle, peristyle in English, is a Greek and Roman word for a column-lined court. The columns of Diocletian's palace were imported from Egypt and, along with some sphinxes, predate the rest of the palace by almost 1,800 years. Immediately next to the peristyle, The split ethnographic museum is in a building that itself is an exhibit, the former bedrooms of Emperor Diocletian himself. The museum's collection shows aspects of everyday life through the centuries for residents of Split, Islanders, and the Dalmatian hinterland, including some surprisingly ornate cooking and farming implements. One section of the museum is the 7th century church of St. Andrew de Fenestris, one of the oldest in the city. At the museum exit is a Roman staircase leading to the roof and a 360-degree view of Split. Like all of Croatia, multiple empires have controlled Split over the centuries. The Narodni Trg, People's Square, is the best single place in Split to see this set in stone. The old town hall is Venetian, the restaurant to the south is Napoleonic French, and the hotel to the west is Habsburg Austrian. Also, like much of central Split, the People's Square has a more festive vibe at night. Most of the time, however, the different styles aren't as clear-cut. Some industrious homeowner slapped some Venetian windows on a house that was already part French, part Romanesque. There's also some original Roman cornices on the adjacent building. Then there's this original Roman tower that looks like it has a Venetian building growing out of it. Outside the original walls lies the Riva, or waterfront, that connects the city to the port. In the original palace, boats docked right up against the walls. Land reclamation for a new port and waterfront was started in the Napoleonic era, but the modern Riva was just completed in 2007. Sunset at the waterfront colors the buildings wonderfully. In general, the Riva is a place to feed, sell to, and entertain tourists, and can apparently get pretty crazy during a peak cruise boat season, as these rather creative warning signs in an alley just inside the walls can attest to. A fuller history of Diocletian's palace is detailed and fascinating, and deserving of its own video, which will be coming in another installment. There's a lot to explore outside the center of Split as well. There are several beaches that are either a long walk or a short bus or Uber ride from the center. The closest is by far the most crowded, so we avoided that one. Another is close to a marina on the north side of the Marjan Peninsula, where we happened to catch some locals working on their boat and also playing bocce. The beach itself, more popular with locals than tourists, had some wonderfully shaded picnic areas as well as a roped-off area for swimming. The third beach we found was on the south side of the peninsula, also a local hangout that's down the hill from a cicada-filled copse of trees. Nearby, also on the south side of the peninsula, is the Galleria Meštrović, a museum dedicated to and former summer home of Ivan Meštrović. Meštrović is the most famous Croatian sculptor and the greatest sculptor that we'd never heard of. He studied in both Split and Vienna around the turn of the 20th century and had his first public exhibition in Vienna prior to the First World War. His works were known throughout Europe, earning him praise from the great Auguste Rodin, among many others. After World War II, he was offered a professorship at Syracuse University and moved to the United States in 1946. He taught there until 1955, when he moved to teach at the University of Notre Dame, where he stayed until his death in 1962. Meštrović's works around Split include St. John the Baptist in the Temple of Jupiter and Bishop Gregory of Nin, just outside the north gate of the palace. We also hiked up Marion Hill to get a different perspective on Split. The trail runs the entire length of the peninsula, but we only explored a small part of it. The hill is a popular place for locals and visitors to exercise. After climbing a lot of steps, the path flattens out until it's finally a level track. There are places to rest and a potable water fountain. I was able to catch two ferries passing each other on the route to the nearby island of Hvar. Venturing even farther beyond Old Town, I rented a bike to go see one remnant of Diocletian's original aqueduct. Destroyed by the Goths in the 6th century, the aqueduct was reconstructed by the Austro-Hungarian Empire in the 19th century and used as the city's water supply until 1932, when a modern water station was built nearby. Even farther away from Split, we tried out a half-day boat tour that took us to the ancient port of Trogir, plus two swimming/snorkeling stops on the nearby islands of Drvenik Beli and Sjovo. Inhabited for more than 3,600 years and a UNESCO protected cultural site since 1997, Trogir sits on a small island between the mainland and the much larger island of Sjovo. Trogir features a beautiful port, Venetian buildings, narrow streets, and the 15th century Camerlengo fortress. The first swimming stop is called the Blue Lagoon off Drvenik Veli, meaning large forest. The water is beautiful and crystal clear, with the occasional fish, but really there's nothing much to see. The second swimming stop off Sjovo was even less remarkable, though the scenery along the ride back to Split was memorable. Given the availability of beaches near Split and the cheaper water taxi options to Trogir, the per-person 50 euro price of the tour simply wasn't worth it to us. The one caveat was docking back in Split. As the boat stopped right on the riva and not on one of the outer piers, it was pretty cool to imagine what it would have been like to sail up to the palace in Diocletian's day. Our final day trip outing was to the town of Hvar on the island of Hvar, leaving from the Split ferry pier in the morning. Croatia has over 700 islands, second only to Greece in the Mediterranean. Hvar is the fourth largest. Brač, which we pass along the way, is third. The port town of Hvar has a growing reputation as a playground for the rich, and while its overall vibe is too posh for our tastes, there are enough interesting sights to make for a good day trip. The first and foremost sight is the Fort Fortica, built in the early 16th century by the Venetians. The trail up the hill is a good workout, and you pass some beautiful local plants. There are plenty of benches to rest along the way, including some recliners at the final base of the fort. Fortica itself is moderately sized, but interesting to tour. The entry fee was sufficient to turn away many would-be visitors, keeping the crowd small, and you can grab some refreshments at the cafe inside. The payoff for the climb up the hill is the panoramic view of the town under the proudly flying Croatian flag. Back down at the water, a promenade heads away from the port, past several restaurants and several swimming areas. We ended up at a smaller marina around a couple bends to cool ourselves off with a refreshing dip in the Adriatic. We hope that you enjoyed our video. If you did and want to see more from us, please help us out with the YouTube algorithm and hit like on the video, subscribe on our channel, and feel free to share. Follow.